Welcome. On Easter Sunday, we know the call and response very well. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Indeed, Christ is risen. Alleluia. And we are here to celebrate on this Easter Sunday morning, to worship Jesus for all that he's done for us on Good Friday, on Easter Sunday morning, dying, rising from the dead. What a reason to celebrate. Now, it is a little bittersweet for us while we are under the quarantine because of the coronavirus, because normally we get to gather together in Christian fellowship and love and to share in this celebration on this joyous day of Jesus' resurrection. Unfortunately, we are not able to do that in person this year, but we do, thank God, have a form of virtual or online community in which we can share this church service and watch it from our homes, our living rooms, our computers, and we can still share a little bit of Christian community, of electronic community in that way. That being said, just a housekeeping, a kind of ground rule announcement for our online service. Treat this service as you would a regular worship service, as if you were sitting out there in the pews in the Lord's house on the Lord's day. If you were sitting in the pews, you wouldn't take a phone call. You would silence your phones. You wouldn't go do whatever, check that the popcorn was still popping or whatever. Treat it as if you're sitting in the pews, the Lord's house, the Lord's day, and take this opportunity to worship your Lord, give thanks to him for everything he's done for you in his resurrection, and to receive the blessed gift of his word and the proclamation that he is in fact risen from the dead and alive to this very day and forevermore. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And with that, let us begin with our opening hymn, hymn number 474, Alleluia, Jesus is risen.
Thank you. continue on page 184 of your hymnal. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the introit. I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. Your right hand, O Lord, glorious in power. Your right hand, O Lord, shatters the enemy. You have led in your steadfast love the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them by your strength to your holy abode. You will bring them in and plant them on your own mountain, the place, O Lord, which you have made for your abode, the sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established. The Lord will reign forever and ever. Through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome death and opened the gate of everlasting life to us. Grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of our Lord's resurrection may be raised from the dead of sin by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The first reading for the resurrection of our Lord is from Acts chapter 10. Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The gradual. Christ has risen from the dead. God the Father has crowned him with glory and honor. He has given him dominion over the works of his hands. He has put all things under his feet. The epistle is from Colossians chapter 3. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We rise in honor of the Holy Gospel. According to St. Matthew, the 28th chapter. Glory to thee, O Lord. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." This is the Gospel of the Lord. We confess our Christian faith using the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 191 of your hymnal. We confess, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds with the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We continue with our hymn of the day. Hymn number 457, Jesus Christ is Risen Today.
Joy on them, holy day.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Jesus indeed is risen, and you too will rise. And that matters. And so we say, Alleluia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. My sermon title this morning is this, They Took Hold of His Feet. And that comes from Matthew chapter 28, our gospel reading. So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, Greetings. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. So there early on the morning of that first Easter Sunday, we are told it is dawn of the first day of the week. These two women, the two Marys, went to the tomb to check things out and to find out how Jesus' body was doing. Now, this term, fake news, has been rolling around in our vocabulary for the past few months and few years, fake news. And sometimes it's a term used to smear someone or some sort of report. And so the women going to discover the tomb, that it was empty, this is really bad fake news. It would be bad fake news, news which is used to malign the Christian church and the Christian witness about Jesus Christ. Because if this was a made-up story, the resurrection of Jesus, it would not have been the women who find the tomb empty. Women's testimony in court in the ancient world was worth less than a man's testimony. So if this was a made-up story right off the bat, it would not be the women finding the tomb empty and discovering that Jesus had risen, but it would be the triumphal disciples, the triumphal apostles, who in great faith would have come to the tomb already knowing what was going to happen. But no, it was the women who find that Jesus is no longer in the tomb. And by the way, hardened unbelievers, hardened skeptics of Christianity have looked at the facts of the resurrection, and one of them being this, that the women find the tomb empty. And they look at the case for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and they say it is a solid historical case, but founded on very solid historical facts, that indeed the resurrection did happen. But when it comes down to it, they just cannot believe that someone would rise from the dead like that because of their materialist presuppositions and assumptions. And so the unbeliever says, after looking, taking an honest look at the case of the resurrection, the unbeliever says, I cannot accept it morally. I will not choose to believe that because I cannot believe that. Not because the evidence is not there. With that aside behind us, anyway, the two women went to the tomb to discover that it was empty. And when they got there, a spectacular chain of events starts to happen. There is an earthquake. A spectacular angel whose appearance is like lightning descends from heaven with white robes, very dazzling to the eyes. This angel rolls the stone away from the tomb and then victoriously perches himself on the stone. A nice little detail of the gospel account from Matthew, that the angel sits on the stone in victory, knowing full well what Jesus had done in being raised from the dead. And of course, the Roman guard that is there, as well as the woman, they experience great fear at seeing the angel descend from heaven and all the events that surround that. So the angel, as is usually the case in the scriptures when someone encounters an angel, the angel has to calm their fears and say, do not be afraid. And of course, they should not be afraid, because he goes on to say then that Jesus is not here. Jesus is not here, but he has risen. He has risen. The very same reason why we are here today watching this video service on Easter Sunday, we are celebrating the fact that Jesus is risen. And that great word, Alleluia, we have been taking a fast from our Alleluias. That great word of praise to God has come roaring back into our church service, and we can say Alleluia again in the season of Easter. The angel goes on, he is risen. Go and tell his disciples that he is risen. And so Matthew tells us that the woman went quickly with fear and great joy. It must have been just a very emotional time for the women discovering that Jesus was raised from the dead, and their emotions were just overflowing in them, hurrying back to tell the disciples. But Matthew then gives us this glorious account of this encounter with Jesus. The women, behold, it says, they meet Jesus. And Matthew squeezes this spectacular encounter into just three short verses in his gospel account. You wish that there could be more, but this is one of the first resurrection appearances of Jesus to these women. Interestingly, Jesus, in the biggest understatement in the whole Bible, he gives them a simple greetings. He says greetings, or you could translate it simply as hi, hello. Very much an understatement considering what just happened on Good Friday, and then his death on the cross, his rest in the tomb, and his glorious resurrection. Jesus simply says to them, hi. It's an interesting feature of this encounter. But in this greeting, we see Jesus' great love and his forgiveness and his goodwill shining through. Because he says at the end of this encounter to the women, he says, go and tell my brothers. Go and tell my brothers. There, Jesus is referring to the disciples, the apostles, who did not stay by Jesus' side, but left him and fled to leave him alone, even denying him like Peter. Jesus didn't say, go and tell those betrayers. He didn't say, go and tell those cowards. No, he said, go and tell my brothers. He claims the disciples as his own brothers. And here, Jesus shows his great love and mercy and forgiveness to them. All is forgiven. He has won their salvation on the cross, and he has been raised for their justification. He has forgiven them. He shows them that great forgiveness by calling them my brothers. He shows that forgiveness to them, and he shows that forgiveness to us as well. Jesus forgives us with this declaration of my brothers. Because remember, we learned on Good Friday that you yourself would have been right there with the Jewish crowds shouting, crucify him, crucify him. It wasn't just the Jewish crowds and Pilate who were responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. It is all of us sinners. All of us have nailed Jesus to the cross by our sins. That is why he went to the cross. And so, by Jesus calling the disciples my brothers, he shows them his great forgiveness for the disciples, and he shows his great forgiveness for you. Jesus is pleased to call you his brother, his sister, in forgiveness and love and mercy. Wow. Now, interestingly also, as the title of my sermon would suggest, interestingly, the women take hold of Jesus' feet. What's that all about? Jesus standing there and the women grab his feet? Now, why would they do something like that? It seems a little odd. Now, at the very basic level, them grabbing Jesus' feet shows indeed that Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. And that it matters that he is alive. Jesus is alive, and it matters. Now, there's been some scholars who have done some work on this, what it means for the woman to grab Jesus' feet. And interestingly, in the ancient world, the accounts of ghosts, you know, they have accounts of ghosts that are, you know, these kind of mists or a spiritual appearance of someone. But in all the accounts of ghosts in the ancient world, they never have feet, the ghosts. They don't have feet. So in the ancient world, as well as today, ghosts do not have feet. Think about it. What do all the pop culture references and depictions of ghosts look like? It looks like a beach ball with a bedsheet draped over it, floating around. There's no feet to that ghost. And so when the women grab that, when the women see that it is Jesus, they grab his feet to make sure that it's really him and not just some sort of appearance or a spirit or a ghost or something that looks like Jesus, but they grab his feet to see that he is physically, bodily, alive, or in the flesh, as we say. Peter, the apostle, in our first reading from Acts chapter 10, he makes much the same point about Jesus being physically, bodily alive when he's preaching to the first Gentile converts to Christianity, to Cornelius and his household. He goes on to tell them how Peter and the many other witnesses of the resurrection, how they were witnesses of the physically, bodily raised from the dead Christ. And they said that we are the witnesses who ate and drank with Jesus after he rose from the dead. Ghosts don't eat and drink, but living, breathing, alive human beings eat and drink and have feet. So Jesus is truly alive forevermore, bodily. And this great truth is taught to us on that starting on Easter, Jesus is alive, physically, bodily, never to die again, ever. Something marvelous and spectacular happened on Easter. Other people had died and raised, had been raised from the dead before, like especially Lazarus. We just heard about him and Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. But Lazarus, he was more resuscitated. He would eventually, he was still mortal. He would again taste the sleep of death after a certain time. But Jesus is unique in all of human history in that he took on our flesh, he took on our physical, mortal nature, and he died, but he rose again on that first Easter, never to die again. Jesus is still alive today and will always be that way in his body. He turned death back and he defeated sin. And of course, sin uses death as a weapon against us. Jesus defeated sin, and necessarily he defeated sin's weapon, death, as well. And so he is called the first fruit, the first fruits of those who rise from the dead. And we see a prototype of the resurrection that we will have on the last day when Jesus raises us, Christians, from the dead. We will be alive forevermore, bodily, physically, just like Jesus is. Jesus is alive, and it matters. Easter matters because you will rise too. Jesus is alive, and you will rise too. Now, importantly, Easter teaches us something very crucial to the Christian faith, is that God cares a lot. God cares a lot about creation. After all, he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to take on human flesh, to be crucified on the cross for the sins of the world, and to rise again from the dead, to redeem and restore his fallen creation. Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit, all, the Holy Trinity, they care a lot about creation. They are interested in redeeming and restoring creation, as well as that includes your physical body. That includes your flesh. God cares about your body. And that means that your bodies matter. Your bodies matter to God, They matter. It matters what you do with your bodies. It matters what you do to your bodies. Easter teaches us that our bodies matter. Indeed, all of creation matters. The very stuff that God has made, he didn't want to destroy it or to lose it to sin and death. He wanted to redeem it. Think about just sticking your hand into some loose soil in the ground and picking that up with your hand and the dirt falling through your fingertips and how it feels cool to the touch falling through your fingers and on your hand. God cares about this creation. And we are not just brains in a jar, you know, here to consume media and entertainment and just, you know, do the things that pertain to the mind. God gave us a body, and it matters. Easter teaches that for sure. There was a movie that came out a few decades ago now called The Matrix, and it was this premise kind of a brain in a jar in that dystopian future. In the Matrix, the human beings in that world, they were being used by the machine overlords. Their bodies were being used as batteries to generate power for these machines. And while the bodies were generating power, the people were simply asleep, and they were having what could be called good dreams. And so they were just sitting there having these good dreams. Now, interestingly, our modern technology has really kind of reduced us in many ways much more to like these brains in a jar, just sitting here taking in things on our TV screens, on our video screens, on our phone screens, on our computer screens. We're just absorbing entertainment almost like we're simply brains in a jar, but we're so much more than that. And trust me, I understand the irony is not lost on me that you are watching this video broadcast from a computer screen. But that being said, we are thankful to God that he has provided us with a means of getting his words out while under quarantine. And yet, our bodies matter. They are important. Easter teaches us that. Jesus is alive, and it matters. After all, the women, they grabbed Jesus' feet, and there they likely felt the nail marks in the sides of his heels where that great spike was driven through both of his feet to nail them to the cross and hold him there while he died a painful death. Jesus is alive bodily, and it matters. It matters for our bodies, for they too will be raised. And it matters for our bodies today in the here and now, even while we still face our enemy death and we still have mortal bodies. We are waiting for our mortal body to put off its mortality and to put on immortality in the resurrection. But it matters how we use our bodies today to serve other people. Now, in the current context, under the coronavirus quarantine, we have to do things a little differently in the church, and we have to celebrate Easter differently this year, sadly, that means. However, this is not the first time the church, in her long history, has encountered plague. This isn't our first rodeo, so to speak. For there has been many plagues throughout history in which that have ravaged our world, that have ravaged the church even. But interestingly enough, it was the resurrection of Jesus and Christians' early belief in the same, the resurrection of Jesus, that gave them strength and confidence in the face of plague and calamity and disaster. For in the ancient world, in the first 300 years, the first three centuries of this age of the church, in the first 300 years AD, there were plagues that would ravage the Roman Empire in different places in the Roman Empire. And interestingly enough, it was the early Christians' belief in the resurrection that caused them to face these plagues. Now, it was common practice for the wealthy pagans in those days, when they saw the first sign of plague, they would flee to their vacation homes in the countryside and wait out. Well, the chaos worked itself out in the city, and the plague died down, and a lot of people would die. but they would be safe out in their country homes fleeing from the plague, or that was the goal. But a lot of Christians, what happened was they would stay back because they knew that Jesus had conquered death in the resurrection. They would stay back and take care of the plague victims out of Christian love for them, because they knew that Jesus was alive and it mattered how they used their body now in the here and now to love and serve their neighbor. And humanly speaking, this is what accounts in a large part for the explosive growth of the early Christian church, so that it grew so large it eventually took over the Roman Empire, Christianity did, and now Christianity today is the largest religion in the world. And it was because these Christians, and they had the confidence in taking care of the plague victims because of their belief in the resurrection of Jesus Christ and in their own resurrection, that after taking care of these plague victims, the survival rate went up drastically. Because even just doing things like basic food, basic water, basic shelter, basic care, it increased the survival rate of plague victims many times. And so it's not very hard to explain the gospel to someone who is on death's doorstep and then receives the love and care of Christians who believe in Jesus and believe in the resurrection of the dead, for them to ask, "So tell me more about this Jesus Christ whom you worship." This is not the first time the church has encountered plague. And Jesus lives, and you too shall rise, and it matters. And in this day of the coronavirus quarantine, we Christians will have many roles to play, both in the immediate context and in the long-term future. There's going to be a lot of different ways where we can serve and love our neighbor as Christians. And for some of you, that means that you're going to be on the front lines, and your vocation is going to call you to put yourself in harm's way in terms of the coronavirus and to care for people on the front lines. And our prayers go out to you. For others of us, it means loving and serving our neighbor will mean that we should stay home, and we should not needlessly endanger, or we should not needlessly cause the coronavirus to spread by our actions and things like that. So we are to stay home and only do essential business. There are many different ways in which we can use our bodies that have been redeemed by Jesus' death and resurrection to love and serve our neighbor. Jesus is alive, and it matters. And finally, in closing, I would like to address anyone who is listening to this message, because we are having a greater reach now online with posting our videos. There may be many who are listening to this who are not necessarily members of our church or members of, believers in Jesus Christ. And so I address you, those who do not believe in Jesus and his resurrection. Jesus is alive. He died and rose for you. If you don't believe that, I encourage you and invite you today to believe it. And if you have any questions, we are on the internet. Just search Grace St. John Lutheran online. You'll find us, our website, our Facebook page, our YouTube channel. You will find us. It's easy to find us. Get in contact with me. I am willing to talk to you about any questions you have about Christianity, about Jesus, about his death and resurrection for you. I would be happy to do that. Or if you know a member of our congregation in Grace Lutheran Church or St. John Lutheran Church, please reach out to them. If you have a friend, they'll be happy to talk to you about Jesus or to direct you to me so that I can answer any questions that you have and share with you more about Jesus' glorious death and resurrection for you. And in closing, we say one more time, the call and response, because Jesus is alive and you too shall rise and it matters, we say the call and response, Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And now the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus until life everlasting. Amen. At this time, we continue with the offertory on page 192 of your hymnal.
continue with the offering. We continue with the prayers of the church. In our prayers this morning, we bring several specific petitions before the Lord, including praying for the family of Steve Doherty, that is Jody Doherty's husband, Jody a member at St. John Lutheran Church. Steve died in the Lord this past Tuesday, and with the coronavirus quarantine going on, his funeral will be coming up at an undetermined time in the future, once we can have larger gatherings. But we pray for Steve, we pray for his family, we pray especially for Jody, that they would be comforted at this time with the hope of the resurrection, the very resurrection we celebrate today on Easter Sunday. Also, a few praises to praise the Lord. We give God thanks and praise for the successful surgery that Karen Hardwick, St. John's member, had to remove a mass from her abdomen this past week. She is now at home and recovering, so we give God thanks and ask for a quick and speedy recovery. And finally, one other prayer request and praise, and that is the Bible says in Psalm 127 that children are a heritage from the Lord, and that the fruit of the womb is a reward. I am happy to announce to you that Jenny and I are expecting baby number 4. And so we rejoice together in that and give thanks to God. The due date is actually Reformation Day of this year, otherwise known as October 31st. So we pray to God for a safe and healthy pregnancy and birth and delivery for both mother and child. I will conclude each prayer petition with, "Lord, in your mercy," to which the congregation responds, "Hear our prayer." Let us pray. Rejoicing in the resurrection of our Lord and sharing in his peace, let us pray to the Lord on behalf of ourselves and all people as they have need. O risen Savior, set free our tongues to confess your resurrection before a world still captive to sin and death. Give us courage to go to every place and to speak in every language the salvation won for us upon the cross and the hope granted to us of life that death cannot overcome. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O risen Savior, anoint the words of those who preach to us your gospel, and open our ears to hear with faith all that Jesus has done to save us. Raise up many who will serve you in the various callings of your church, and who will serve us in your name, with your word and your gifts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O risen Savior, hear us on behalf of President Trump, Governor Evers, the Congress of the United States, and all state and local elected officials. Guide them according to your word, that their labors for our nation's health and welfare may not be in vain, nor that they would be forgetful of the vulnerable, aging, and unemployed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O risen Savior, hear us on behalf of those who cry to you in any need, especially the sick, the suffering, the disabled, the wounded in spirit, those who suffer mental illness, those in their last last days on earth in the morning. Especially do we pray for the family of Steve Doherty, and especially Jody, his wife. We also lift up before you Karen Hardwick. Give them grace according to their need, and sustain them in their afflictions to the day when their suffering will be exchanged for glory and the life of the world to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O risen Savior, we thank you for blessing the marriage of Jennifer and myself with the gift of another child. Look favorably upon Jenny and the child she carries, that they may safely come to the time of birth. Grant that by water and the word, this child may be brought to new birth and regeneration in the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O risen Savior, accept the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving from our lips and the tithes and offerings we bring this day. Increase in the hearts of your people delight in your mercy, gratitude for all your benefits, and eagerness to support the mission of your church in word and deed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. All praise to you, dear Father in heaven, for you have opened to us the way to eternal life in the resurrection of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We give you thanks for all those who have gone before us in the faith and now rest from their labors. Keep us in that same faith and embolden us by your resurrection to be fearless in the face of disease, chaos, loneliness, and every sorrow of this world. Give us with Job the solemn expectation to cheer us, our Redeemer lives, and we too shall be resurrected and glorified to live with him in his eternal kingdom through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our resurrected Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. We continue with our closing hymn, hymn number 493, a hymn of glory, let us sing.
Alleluia, alleluia, Christ my all.
Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Now, normally at the end of the service, we would have an opportunity to fellowship with each other, to shake each other's hands, to shake my hand on the way out, and to share Christian friendship and love at the end of the service as we celebrate our Lord's resurrection. Unfortunately, again, due to the quarantine, we are not able to have that fellowship together, which we yearn and long for, and it will be so sweet when we can come back together again. But in the meantime, while we are unable to share fellowship in person, let us leave a virtual handshake by leaving a comment in the description below, in the comment box below, either Facebook or YouTube. If you don't know how to leave a comment, ask a young person. Any young person will be very familiar with this whole process, but find out how to leave a comment. Just say hello, how are you doing, good morning, happy Easter, anything. Just leave a comment as if you were giving a virtual handshake to your friends and family in Christ on this Easter Sunday. And related to that, I would just encourage you also to share this video. Post it to your Facebook wall, share it, find out how to share it via email. Share this video because this is an interesting opportunity which our Lord has given us. While we have been forced to go underground, so to speak, and to do our church service online, we now have an unprecedented opportunity to share God's word and this message of the Easter resurrection of Jesus much farther beyond the walls of our church than normally we are able to do. You might not be able to preach on a street corner to hundreds and thousands of people, telling them the gospel, but you can do something as simple as sharing this video and the preaching and the proclamation. It will all be done for you on the video. But just share this video so that your family and friends and those outside of the walls of the church can see this video. And with that, we close with one more call and response, celebrating the great and glorious resurrection of our Lord. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.